In this talk, I would like to present some results that were obtained in collaboration with several institutions, in particular with Warsaw University and Institute of Nanotechnology in Lecce, where experiments were performed, and Nanyang University of Technical University of Singapore. I would also like to underline the contribution of my PhD student Andrzej Opala. So I will start with a brief introduction to neural networks. I will make it brief because probably most of you have heard a lot about them. So what is machine learning? Well, we know that computers are very powerful. They can solve very tasks very efficiently, much more efficiently than humans. But there are some tasks that are very hard to implement using algorithms. So in particular, it is very difficult to write an algorithm that would recognize an object in different scenarios, from different viewpoints. This kind of tasks are characterized by the property that you need to combine a very large number of weak rules with complex dependencies. For example, you have to recognize eyes of the cat, nose, the position, and so on. And it is very hard to write an algorithm for a human that would do this step by step. However, these tasks are very easy for humans. So for example, none of us would have any problem telling that there is a cat in each of this photo. So in recent years, there was a huge breakthrough in machine learning, and it is connected to neural networks. Not only, but in a large part to neural networks. So in machine learning, what you do, you don't write an algorithm that step by step are going to perform this task. You write an algorithm that constructs a neural network that with tunable weights. So each neuron is connected to another neuron by some weight, which is tunable, tuned by, during teaching. And you provide a number of examples that are used for teaching. So you provide, for example, images of cats. And then the task of the network is to activate a neuron in the last layer if there is this object in this photo. And the applications of neural networks are really large now in the industry. So there, for example, autonomous cars are based on machine learning, speech recognition that we use in our phones, fraud prevention in finance, also language models that are used for translation, but also whenever you use a Google search engine, we also are communicating with a neural network, as well as in medical diagnosis. For example, recently Google was able to present an algorithm that is better in recognizing certain tumors in photos, is better than humans, actually, than professionals. So, but I would like to point out that there is a problem with this machine learning. The existing machine learning algorithm require processing of very large amounts of data, which consumes valuable resources. For example, if we want to teach this Google language model, it requires about 5,000 hours of GPU time, which is equivalent to more than 1,000 pounds of CO2 emission. This is comparable to a single passenger trip from New York to San Francisco. And this problem will become even more important because if we look at the trends of global electricity usage and CO2 emissions, then depending on which scenario we pick, in the worst case scenario, we will have in 2030 even more than 50% of electricity and CO2 emissions due to information technology. So the strain on computation is really growing. And this problem is related to the breakdown of Moore's law. Moore's law is a phenomenological law that says that every 2 years, the number of transistors on a chip is doubling. And this law was working very good until a certain point. But at some point, something happened, and this trend in the performance of computers actually is now saturating. So if we look at the clock speeds, then these are actually saturated since about 2000. And this is related to the breakdown of Dinard scaling. Dinard scaling states that as the density of transistors on a chip is increasing, the power consumption is more on certain surface is more or less constant. So we could rely on this to build more and more powerful computers at practically at the cost of the same energy. However, at some point in 2007, this Dinard scaling started to fail, and nowadays it's practically dropped to zero. So what is the answer? What can we do with this? If we want to build efficient neural networks, one of the ways is to build is the so-called neuromorphic computing approach. In this approach, we build neural networks in hardware. So nowadays, neural networks, artificial neural networks, are based on computer simulation. So the network only exists in memory of the computer. However, if we were able to somehow resemble this network in hardware, this could bring a lot of benefits in terms of efficiency. And this comes also from the fact how computers are built. Computers are built in according to the so-called von Neumann computer architecture, where we have a CPU unit and memory, which is separate, physically separate from CPU. And they are connected by a bus, by a communication channel. And this communication channel is a bottleneck if we have to exchange information between CPU and memory quite a lot. And this is the case for neural network simulations. Now, one of the first prototypes of neuromorphic systems was the True North chip developed by IBM, which contained about 1 million neurons. And it was built in such an architecture. So you can see that here, neurons and synapses. So neurons are like computational units, and synapses are memory of these neurons. These are weights of the neurons. And they are physically close to each other. And the communication is only necessary between units containing different neurons. And this architecture allowed to achieve power consumption, which is about 100 times lower than CPU in a machine learning task, which was recognizing objects in an image from a camera on the street. So this kind of systems are developed in many companies, such as IBM, Intel, Google, as well as many universities. There are also two very big projects in the EU and US which include this development of this kind of systems. But in this talk, I would like to indicate that we can think of photons as possible way to even speed up even more this computation and overcome some bottlenecks. So, if we compare electrons and photons, we know that electrons are excellent for information processing. On the other hand, photons are excellent for communication. For example, we are using waveguides to communicate on long distances. Electrons are characterized by substantial interactions, which is very helpful for this information processing. Photons interact very weakly and only in nonlinear media. On the other hand, electrons you incur high losses, whereas photons incur low losses, especially if we think of high bandwidths. So can we think of optical neural networks? Well, actually, this is not a new idea. This idea was actually developed before I was born, so in the 70s. And there was a number of papers in the 70s and 90s that were devoted to possible realization of computation with photons. For example, it is possible to realize vector matrix multiplication in a quite straightforward way by using the properties of Maxwell equation. So if we have a number of light sources that represent a vector and a mask that represents and the matrix that we want to multiply this vector by, then in the certain plane, if we use a certain optical system, we can obtain the result of the multiplication. So it looks nice, but and this functionality was quite wide. However, the systems were never able to actually find any application. And this was due to several factors. So one of the factors was that electronics were developing very rapidly, according to Moore's law. Another factor is that digital electronics is universal, whereas these devices could only perform some specific operations. It was also impractical because optical elements are quite bulky, whereas electronics can be integrated on chip, and it's very important. And also, apart from communication, it was never really demonstrated that photonics is better in speed and energy efficiency. So I would like to convince you that now the situation is changing somehow. So first of all, the Moore's law is no longer valid, and we have to look for some other solutions. Second, there is a growing need for application-specific devices, even in electronics, such as GPUs and TPUs that just perform simple operations. On the other hand, now photonics can be integrated on a chip, and I will show you some examples. And the advent of photonics is likely to be demonstrated in the near future, in my opinion, and I hope that it will be due to exciton polaritons. So to show you some example of integrated optical devices, I will show some recent experiments. So in this series of papers, these researchers developed a system that is called broadcast and wait, which is a realization of a neural of a neuron or neural networks based on ring resonators that provide weighting of the optical signal and photodiodes that can receive optical signal and translate it to electrical signal, both with positive and negative weight. So this is like a hybrid electronic optical device, and one can build simple neural networks using this kind of systems. Another system is based on a system of Mach-Zehnder interferometers. So we have a laser light coming from as an input. We have Mach-Zehnder interferometers, which are arranged in such a way that they perform some unitary operation on the incoming light. There is also a diagonal matrix, which provides weights, and another unitary transformation. So in total, these three operations can perform any linear operation. And this system was used to perform spoken vowel recognition. Another approach is using so-called diffractive layers. So light coming from as an input is going through a series of layers that are patterned in such a way that they, propagation of light is mapped to a neural network. And it was shown that, for example, one can build such a system, which as if in the input one has a handwritten digit or some object to recognize, at the output a certain detector is activated. This was done both in the microwave regime and in the optical regime. Also, convolutional neural networks, which are very important for image recognition, can be built using optics. And it was realized both in the case of integrated devices, depicted here, and free space optics. And in another interesting example is an all-optical spiking network that is resembling actual action of a biological network that is based on spikes. And here also ring resonators were used for weighting of the signal, and phase change material was used as device which is summing the signal and performing the nonlinear operation. And this network successfully was used to recognize patterns. And another approach to neural networks is based on reservoir computing. Reservoir computing is a type of architecture of a neural network in which a large part of neurons are static and connected, usually connected in a random way. So if we are teaching the network, these connections are not changed. So this is completely static. The only thing that is tuned during teaching is the output layer. And the advantage of this scheme is that we don't need to tune anything in this part. So we can use a system which is not tunable. And teaching is very simple because if we have only one layer, we can use a linear regression to perform the teaching. We don't need any advanced algorithms. And this approach was actually quite successful. And here is an example where an optical system of interconnected nodes was used for recognition of human movements, human actions, such as boxing, clapping, jogging, and so on. Oops. So now I would like to move to polariton neural networks. Why do we want to consider polariton neural networks? Well, I was mentioning before that photons are interacting very weakly. This is a problem for computing and for in general and for neural networks as well, because if we want to build a neural network which is performing a complicated task with high accuracy, we need some kind of nonlinearity. And this is very crucial that the activation function of the neuron is nonlinear. So the question is, can we have substantial interactions as in the case of electrons and low communication losses that we would like to have in photons? And the answer is that there is such a particle, exciton polariton, which kind of has both these good properties. So exciton polaritons are excitations in microcavities. So these are semiconductor heterostructures where between two very high reflectivity mirrors, there is very high quality mode, photonic mode, which is strongly coupled to excitons. So excitation of electrons and holes in a semiconductor. And these particles have at the same time excellent transport properties and extremely low effective mass thanks to this photonic part and very strong interparticle interactions thanks to the excitonic component. And in fact, this is a world record of ultra-fast optical nonlinearity. Theoretically, one can describe exciton polaritons using this simple Hamiltonian where we have excitations of excitons, photons and coupling between them, a simple coupling. So if we diagonalize the simple Hamiltonian, we will get two branches, upper polariton branch and lower polariton branch. And in this anti-crossing regime, we will have quasi-particles that are both matter and light excitations at the same time. Exciton polaritons were used to demonstrate a number of very nice phenomena, in particular condensation, non-equilibrium condensation of bosons, even at room temperature, but also were used to construct devices such as transistors, both in cryogenic temperature and at room temperature, polaritonic spin switches, and so on. So our idea was to try to implement this reservoir computing with polaritons. So our approach was the following. We will use a lattice of polaritons, polariton micropillars. So here is a micrograph of polaritons which are coupled to each other. They actually overlap each other. So maybe you cannot see that there are micropillars because they are very close. But they can be still described using a simple discrete equation, which includes a resonant injection of pulses in each of the pillar, nearest neighbor coupling, as well as linear and nonlinear losses, pumping, and interactions. And the principle of operation was the following. If we have our task that we considered was recognition of handwritten digits. So we encoded this input as a time series. We multiply this information input by random matrix to redistribute all the signal over the whole lattice, over this reservoir. And now the evolution of polaritons will be evolution of reservoir, and we will monitor it and record it and use this intensity, which can be actually observed directly on a CCD camera, for the teaching algorithm in the last layer. And we were able to perform this task in theory in for handwritten digit recognition and also for spoken word recognition. And our theoretical estimates were quite promising because it turned out that we can we could achieve a speed of recognition which is orders of magnitude better than for other systems. So now I will discuss experiments. So the first experiment was performed in the group of Dalio Barallini and Daniel Sanvito in Lecce. And it was more or less following our idea with some slight modifications. So here, this information was not encoded in time, but encoded in speed using a spatial light modulator. This light was then directed to a sample, which was characterized by very nonlinear response of the transmission. The output was monitored by a CCD camera. And this output was used as information for in the last layer of the network, which applied weights that were determined during teaching and used for classification. And we observed that the accuracy of our system is quite high. Actually, it is highest of any other hardware implementations of reservoir networks. And it was higher than linear regression, which is depicted here with the gray line, which is an important benchmark because it tells that this reservoir computing method actually brings some advantage over linear algorithms. And what is also important that the speed of the system is potentially can be quite large. So the natural timescale of polaritons is in picoseconds. So we can think of terahertz speed. And recently there was another experiment which was performed, realized in University of Warsaw. And in this experiment, we used a different architecture of the network. We used a binarized network. A binarized network is a neural network where the neurons are actually performing some kind of binary operation. And this is a concept developed by the machine learning community. And it turns out that it greatly improves speed and energy efficiency at the cost of minimal reduction of accuracy. So we realized this kind of binary neurons in polariton microcavity by inducing exciton polariton condensation. And this condensation is a nonlinear phenomenon, so it allowed to realize a nonlinear operation of an exclusive OR gate. And we achieved accuracy of 96%, which is similar to state other state of the art neuromorphic hardware realizations. Moreover, we constructed an all-optical exclusive OR gate using additionally some optical paths and weights which were added to the system. And in this case, we observed that the energy efficiency was 16 picojoule per synaptic operation. And this is quite a good efficiency, because for comparison, this IBM True North chip efficiency was about 26 picojoules per synaptic operation. Okay, so finally, I would like to say something about the outlook of polariton neural networks. So to estimate what is the potential efficiency of the system, one can consider such a simple setup. So we have an optical pulse with certain energy. It is going through microcavity, and the polaritons provide some nonlinearity to this pulse. So at the exit of the cavity, we have the same pulse, but there is some phase shift, which is dependent on the energy. So this is a nonlinear effect. And if we can achieve a pi phase shift, it means that we can use this device to perform a useful information. We can estimate this, that the energy cost, minimum energy cost, I mean, by this, the energy of the optical pulse, is about 3 ettojoules, which is 4 orders of magnitude lower than for any other nonlinear optical materials. And using this, we proposed a design of a neural network, a simple neural network, one layer with one hidden layer, which contains polariton nodes and additional setup, which is performing basically a linear operation of multiplication of a vector by a matrix. And this is actually a quite important result for this talk, because in this figure, I show the potential energy efficiency and performance density for different systems. And to get a realistic estimate of efficiency, we took into account also the cost, energy of the light source, modulators, detectors, and optical losses. And we considered two cases: an idealized case for a large scale system where we took parameters of the most state of the art currently available elements, and a case B, where, which is basically a case where we use off the shelf elements and not so good microcavity. And we can see that in both cases, we can see improvement over electronics and other systems in terms of both energy efficiency and the performance, which is number of operations per second per meter squared. Okay, so in conclusion, I try to convince you that integrated optics is promising for information processing. We demonstrated theoretically and experimentally that excitons polarisons is a particularly powerful platform for this. And our theoretical estimates indicates that potentially we can have orders of magnitude or improvements over electronics in terms of speed energy efficiency. So I would like to acknowledge my funding, and also if you are interested, please come and see a poster of Andrzej Opala, which will be on Tuesday. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thanks a lot, Michał. It sounds, I guess it sounds too good to be true somehow. What?
For me too.
But I believe it's true. I believe it's true. So do we have questions? Yes, Marcin, but wait for the mic.
Yeah, so actually I have two questions. So my first question is about those photonics neural networks. So you said, I imagine that there is not much quantum there, yeah? So you are using classical states of light. So my question is, if there is anything you can gain by using like non-classical states, like, I don't know, number states or squid states or something else. And my second question is about those polariton neural networks. So how bulky is the equipment to realize them? Yeah, because you gave an example of a car, yeah, that you need this neural network in an autonomous car, for example. So I don't know, is it possible to put this kind of neural network in a car? Isn't this bulky?
Okay, thank you very much, very good questions. So about the quantum effects, so you are absolutely right that we use no quantum effects in this, at least in this result that I presented in this talk. We can estimate quantum limit, which corresponds to one photon per node, and we are safely above. I mean safely because for me it's easier to consider classical case. But on the other hand, polaritons were already also used for quantum in some quantum settings. So they are not extremely good at quantum stuff, for example, such as quantum dots where you can have single photon sources or so on. But people were observing, for example, G2 smaller than zero with polaritons. So it means that we can try to come closer to this quantum limit, and then we can use actually quantum effects. And actually, I was not talking in here about this, but there is a separate branch of the study which is devoted to quantum neural networks. And it is mostly developed by my colleague Timothy Liu and his group in Singapore. So if you are interested, I can give you references later. And another question was about how bulky it is. So now what we have in the laboratory is the first prototype. So it is quite bulky. It is working in liquid helium. So it's not very practical. However, there are other works which considered neural networks. One moment, maybe I have some. Ah, yeah. So one can think of integrating this whole structure in a such a structure which is micrometer size, because nowadays we have diffractive optical elements which can replace lenses and beam splitters, so bulky optical elements. And it was realized actually experimentally in this work already 20 years ago. So it is possible to design a structure which is integrated and does not have all these bulky elements. The only bulky elements will be the laser. So the laser source is the most bulky element. And also we can have polaritons at room temperature. So we don't need liquid helium for this device to operate.
Okay, we have a question online by Tilman Fauk. Tilman, can you unmute yourself and ask the question yourself?
Yes, yes, I can do that. Thank you for the nice talk, which related quite a bit to my own talk. Now, as you said, all of this is still very classical nonlinearities. I was just wondering how far away are you from the quantum limit? Like, how many photons do your pulses contain, and how far away are you from that single photon nonlinearity, basically? I mean, the polaritons do interact, but usually this interaction is still rather weak, right?
Yes, thank you for this question. So I think it was related to previous question. So actually, there is a number of experiments in polaritons. There's actually a strong drive to obtain quantum effects in polaritons. And there are some initial studies that show, for example, anti-bunching of polaritons. However, in these experiments, in our experiments, we were very far because we did not use a very sophisticated microcavity. We were not pushing towards this limit. If you look at fundamental estimates, it is using current technology. We are close, but not yet in this quantum regime. So, but maybe in the future we will, if we can increase the interactions. There are many ideas how to do it in polaritons. Maybe we can get to this quantum limit.
Okay, so Maciek.
One thing that I didn't understand was that at the beginning, when you were talking about this type of architecture of the networks, you clearly said that you learn only in the last layer, and therefore you can use linear regression methods. So do it like in the standard perceptron or something like that. And then you clearly said that you are better than all the linear regression methods on one of the benchmarking pictures. So can you tell me how is it possible?
Yes. The idea is, maybe I should underline that this idea of reservoir computing, when you also do teaching in the last layer, it was only related to part of my talk in this experiment in Italy. Okay. So now the idea of this reservoir computing is such, if we had no reservoir here, if these inputs were directly connected with the output, then it's linear regression and there is the situation as you say. However, if we have a reservoir, a large number of nodes which are nonlinear and which are kind of transforming the signal in a very multidimensional space, then it turns out that you can improve the accuracy a lot just by having this kind of reservoir, which is not. It's random, so it is not doing anything that you prescribed, but it's still very useful. It improves a lot accuracy if you, and it's actually quite interesting machine learning result in the theory of machine learning.
Okay, great. So I see no further questions. So let's thank Michał again.